So my screen is visible, right?
Ah, screen is visible.
Okay, and the audio is also fine.
Ah, audio is good. No problem.
Okay. So today mainly we want to see sequence and series of functions. So first we see why do we need sequence and series of functions, and then we see what is pointwise convergence, what is uniform convergence, and how to check them. And after that, we will see the previous year questions asked in the CSIR regarding sequence and series of functions. So that is the plan for the day. So first, let's briefly see about the number sequences. Let M, D be a metric space. Xn is a sequence of numbers in the metric space M. Then we say that the sequence Xn is converges to a point X in M if given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a stage n naught belongs to n such that distance between xn comma x is less than epsilon for all n greater or equal to n naught. Okay, so now if we look at this definition, so basically this means that for all epsilon greater than 0, this condition, distance between xn comma x less than epsilon, means that the point xn is lying in the open ball center at center at x of radius epsilon. So you consider the open ball center at x of radius epsilon. This inequality, distance between xn comma x less than epsilon, says that the points xn belongs to this open neighborhood for all n greater than or equal to n naught. Okay, so in other words, so this epsilon is arbitrary. Like, you give epsilon as small as possible, like, yeah, arbitrarily small epsilon you give, then I draw this epsilon neighborhood around the point x. Okay, then corresponding to this open neighborhood around the point x, I can find a stage n naught such that after that stage, every point in that sequence xn should belongs to this neighborhood. Okay, so that is a definition of point number sequence converges to a point. So if you look at this definition, like, this is a definition in arbitrary metric space. Like, as such, the points xn need not be numbers. Like, xn is a sequence of points in M. So, like, for example, set of all 2x2 real matrices, that is a metric space. Okay, so you can thought of set of all 2x2 real matrices, you can identify it with R power 4. If it is a 2x2 matrix, there are 4 entries. So you can identify it with R power 4. R power 4 is a metric space with the usual metric, right? R power n is a metric space. So that way you can make 2x2 matrices also a metric space. So whenever we say something is a metric space, that elements need not be points. It can be matrices, it can be functions, it can be, like, technically it can be any mathematical object, right? So the sequence of functions and the series of functions is like whatever numbers sequences and number series we are doing, that is the similar thing only. Okay, so sequence and sequence of function and the series of function is not something new. Like, we always study arbitrary metric spaces. So if you take the set to consist of functions, and if there is a metric, then we talk about functions convergence in this metric. Okay, so that is one thing. So for example, let's look at e power r, where e is a non-empty subset of real numbers. What is this notation, r power e? It means that set of all functions from e to r. Okay, so whenever we write a power b, this is not functions from a to b. This is I'll write it down. So this is one important notation. Like, so a power b is a set of all functions f from b to a. Okay, so anybody know why we are defining a power b to be set of all functions from b to a? I mean it is natural to define set of all functions from a to b as a power b, right? So anybody have seen some reason why we are defining set of all functions from b to a as a power b?
So is this the cardinality of the set of all functions?
Correct. So if you calculate cardinality of a power b, the set of all functions from b to a, its cardinality will be actually equal to cardinality of a power cardinality of b. Okay, so you define a power b like this. So a power b to be set of all functions from b to a, then if you calculate its cardinality, the number of functions from the set b to a is equal to cardinality of a times cardinality of b. Okay, so like if you define it like this, it is easy. If a and b are finite sets, then it's easy to remember the cardinality. It is cardinality of a times cardinality of b. It is just some one justification, but there may be some other reason also. Yeah. So let's continue. So for our notation, R power e means set of all functions from e to R, all functions. And so this is my M. So if I can make M as a metric space, then its elements will be functions from E to R. And I can consider a sequence in the set M. So now the elements are functions. And I can talk about the convergence in this metric space. Okay. So we need a metric. What is a metric in R power E? That we will see. So we assume that for the time being, there is a metric D in the set M. M is R power E. Then what is the meaning of F and tend to F? So F and tend to F means that the same definition, like we have given a definition for arbitrary metric space, and then this is a one particular metric space in which the elements are functions. So it's the same definition. Given epsilon greater than zero, you can find a stage such that after that stage. Somebody's asking any doubt or
no doubt, some network.
Okay. So given a epsilon greater than zero, you can find a stage such that after that stage, every point should lie within the epsilon distance of the limit point F. Okay, so same definition only. Okay, so now we're going to see if you can think everything from metric space perspective, uniform convergence is easy to visualize. That is what we are trying to understand. So we have some advantage, like if the elements are functions, okay? So if elements are numbers, that is also fine. If the elements are functions, you can do many things with function. For example, like you can check whether the function is continuous or not, function is differentiable or not, function is integrable or not. So in this metric space M, we assume that there is a metric D. We don't know what is this. I haven't said what is a metric, but assume there is a metric D. In this metric, this sequence of function F1 converges to a point F. Okay, since we are dealing with functions, we can ask some natural questions. Suppose F1 is a sequence of continuous function. So the limit function also has to be continuous. Suppose F1 converges to F, then fn prime, will it converge to f prime? That is the derivative of fn prime, will that converge to f prime? So that question also we can ask. Similarly, we can ask, suppose fn tends to f, then integral fn will converge to integral f. So that kind of questions we can ask. Okay, so to answer these questions, like this answer depends on the metric actually. So the limit function will be continuous. Sometimes the limit function won't be continuous. So for example, if the convergence is point-wise, then sequence of continuous function, the point-wise limit need not be continuous. That we will see. But we will see something called supremum norm or infinity metric. Okay, in that norm, we will see that sequence of continuous functions converges to a always converges to a continuous function. Okay, so we're going to do only metric spaces, but from that perspective, everything will be very easy to understand because we know metric space very clearly. Okay, so these are the some questions I said, like suppose fn's are continuous, then f is continuous. So I'm saying suppose fn converges to f in the metric space m comma d, then I just explain you all these questions, so we can just move on. So the third question is, suppose fn's are Riemann or Lebesgue integrable, then the limit function should, limit function is also Riemann integrable or Lebesgue integrable respectively. Suppose fn is Riemann integrable and fn tends to f, and f is Riemann integrable, in that case whether the limit of the integration is equal to integration of the limit function. So this is one thing. So all these things we're going to see very in detail manner. So let's see. So basically we are interested in continuity, differentiation and integration. So the with these three things we're going to connect point wise convergence and uniform convergence, and we're going to understand the theory. Okay. Yeah, so answer is no if the convergence is point wise, like a sequence of continuous function need not converge to a continuous function if the convergence is just point wise. But if the convergence is uniform, then the limit function is always continuous and the limit function will be Riemann integrable also. So I mean, all these things we will see in more detail. Okay, so usually we see, first we see point wise convergence, then we see uniform convergence. So in this talk, first I define what is I'll explain uniform convergence, then we will see what is point wise convergence, because on the way we need a point wise convergence also, but the point wise convergence is easy to understand. So on the way I will just explain what is point wise convergence also. So first I define to explain uniform convergence in a easy way using metric space idea. So I consider C01. So C01 is set of all continuous functions from closed 0, 1 to R. So set of all continuous functions from closed 0, 1 to R. That is our notation, C01. Now, closed 0, 1 is a compact set. Right. So any continuous function and compact set attains its bounds. It means that it will, its minimum also attained, its maximum also attained. So in particular, for any function F belongs to C01, it's a supremum. Supremum means the maximum. Supremum, x belongs to closed 0, 1, f of x. It is a finite number. So less than infinity means it is a finite number. For any f belongs to C01. So what we do, we define a norm. This is called a norm infinity. We are not going to do any function analysis. We are not going to do any norm linear spaces, nothing. For some notation, I have defined the norm, okay? So norm f infinity, I define a norm of a function to be this supremum value, supremum x belongs to closed 0, 1 modulus of x. Okay. Now, if f is a continuous function in closed 0, 1, then mod f is also a continuous function and closed 0, 1. So, mod f is a continuous function and closed 0, 1 means its supremum exists. Therefore, norm of a function, norm of any function in C01, we can calculate this way. So, once we can verify that this indeed defines a norm. Okay, so
supremum of f of x or modulus of f of x?
To define the supremum norm, you need a supremum of mod f of x.
Okay.
Otherwise,
okay.
This norm, otherwise norm won't be positive, right? Norm won't be non-negative.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway. Thanks. Okay. So using this norm infinity, I'm defining a metric. Okay. So this metric is called the D infinity metric. So once you know a norm, how do you define a metric in the norm using norm? So you define norm of f minus g. That is the distance between f comma g. We can define it like this. If this is a norm, this will always satisfy the condition for a metric. Okay, so we can verify that it is actually a metric. So by definition, distance between f comma g in this infinity metric is, so I have to calculate this norm infinity for the function f minus g. So I just put this function f minus g here. So we get supremum x belongs to closed 0, 1 modulus of f of x minus g of x. Note that f minus g is defined point wise. That means that f minus g of x equal to f of x minus g of x. Okay. So that is why. So I have two continuous functions on closed 0, 1 to R. Then the distance between them is defined to be supremum x belongs to closed 0, 1 modulus of f of x minus g of x. Okay, so in the set of all continuous function, now we got a metric. Okay, so we can talk about the convergence. Okay, so what is, I mean, convergence in the metric space. So given epsilon greater than zero, there exists a stage such that after the stage, every point in that sequence should lies within the epsilon radius of the limit. That is the matrix definition. That is a metric definition, metric space definition of convergence that we're going to use. So to talk about the metric definition, first we need to understand the open balls in C 0, 1. Okay, the definition of convergence involve open balls center at the limit of radius epsilon. So for that reason, in C 0, 1, we want to understand what are the open sets or what are the epsilon open ball of a function. Okay. So what is the epsilon neighborhood of the point F? Okay, are they that is what we trying to understand. So this is by definition, set of all functions in C 0, 1, whose distance from F is less than epsilon. So you recall that V of A comma R, open ball center at A of radius, is defined to be set of all X belongs to M. In the metric space, you have to collect points such that distance between A comma X is less than R, right? So that is the same definition I'm writing here. Now my M is C 0, 1. So I have to collect all the points GE which are lying within the distance epsilon from the function F. Okay. So this is the open ball center at F of radius epsilon notation. So yeah, we rewrite this notation and try to understand this open set a little bit more. So distance between F comma G is defined to be supremum of X belongs to close 0, 1 mod F of X minus G of X. And this quantity should be less than epsilon. Okay. Now, if the supremum itself is less than epsilon, then each of this quantity is less than epsilon. Okay. So we can again rewrite this set as set of all G belongs to C 0, 1 such that modulus of f of x minus g of x is less than epsilon for all x belongs to closed interval 0, 1. Okay. So here supremum itself, even supremum is less than means every point here should less than epsilon. Okay. So this is a mathematical description of open ball center at F of radius epsilon. We try to visualize it. Okay. So a function G belongs to open neighborhood of F if so. Hello. So this is
no problem. Some error.
This is B of F comma epsilon. So see, once we understand when a function G belongs to open neighborhood of another function F, then uniform convergence is easy to understand. Okay, so that is why we are doing this. So when a function G belongs to the epsilon neighborhood of a function F, that is a question. So a function G belongs to BF comma epsilon if at every point for all x belongs to close 0, 1, the distance between their images should be less than epsilon. Okay, so we'll try to visualize it, then it will be much easier. So for F, I take the constant function 1. So you note that this is close to 0, 1, and for codomain, I'm considering R. Okay, so this is plus infinity, below we take minus infinity. So any function from close to 0, 1 to R, the functions will be here. Okay. So I take the function F to be constant function 1. So if you see here, this is the constant function 1, which is the function from close 0, 1 to R. And I want to understand what is the epsilon open neighborhood of this constant function 1. Okay. So I take epsilon to be 1/2. So first I draw this two constant function 1/2 and constant function 3/2. I have drawn this two function because the like this is one. So from one, if you go half distance, you will get half as well as 3/2, right? So I am for the time being, I'm drawing these two constant function, and I want to understand. So let's look at this function, this which I drawn in block color black. So this is a continuous function from close 0, 1 to R. Okay, now what is the distance between this constant function one and this black color function? That is what we want to understand. Okay, so if you look at the definition of distance between two functions, so at each point you calculate the distance between the images, then you take the supremum. So basically it means that, so you fix some points in the domain, so domain is close 0, 1, and you look at the images in both the functions, the graph, then you find the distance. So suppose this is my point x, then I look at, so on the function f, this is the image, on the function g, this is the image, then you calculate this distance. This is the distance between these two points, f of x minus g of x. Okay, so note that this vertical distance is the distance between f of x2. So I mean, like this distance is the modulus of f of x2 minus g of x2. So note that this f of x is my constant function one, this black color function is my g of x. Okay, so at the point x2, this is my f of x2, this is my g of x2, then modulus of f of x2 minus g of x2 will be this distance. Okay, so actually f of x2 will be this point, and g of x2 will be this point, because this point is like this is a point in two dimensional, right? So this is like x comma f of x, that's how you visualize this point. So this is domain, so its image will be here. Okay, so we get f of x2 is 1, and the g of x2 is, you go here and you come back, so this point is g of x2. Now whatever the distance here, that is the distance between modulus of f of x, that is the distance between f of x2 and g of x2. So that is one quantity appearing here. Now at all the points you have to calculate the distance between f of x and g of x, then you take the maximum, that is the distance between functions. So let's look at this point x3, then f of x3 and g of x3, they coincide because they have the same image. So at this point, mod f of x3 minus g, modulus of f of x3 minus g of x3 will be 0. Okay, so now if you look at this here, 0, like now if you look at 0, so I call this one point x1, g of x1 is here, half, f of x1 is 1. So now for the point x1, the distance is, distance between f and g is half. Okay, and you can see that at all the other points, the distance between f and g is strictly less than half, because like you see, like because they lies within these two green color functions. So this is my f, this is my f minus 1/2. F minus 1/2 means at all the points you subtract 1/2, this is f plus 1/2. So moral of the story, like the distance between this f of x and g of x is equal to 1/2. Is it clear, the distance between the points f and g is 1/2?
Yes sir, it is.
Okay, so once you know, so therefore the function g is at the distance half, but we want the points which are at the distance utmost half, the distance should be less than half if it is a open neighborhood, right? Therefore g doesn't belongs to b f comma 1/2. So let's look at this function h. So the graph of h is like this. Okay, then similarly, if you calculate the distance between the function f and the function h, you will see that at every point the distance is less than half. See here, the distance between f f and g is it's became half because the this g of x touched this green color lines, okay, because these green color lines are at the distance half from this function f. So if anything staying inside this anything staying between these two lines will be of distance at most half from the function f. That is our observation, okay. So in particular, distance between f and h is less than half, okay. Okay, so similarly you can do for other functions also, like if you consider f of x equal to x and if you want to understand the open ball center at the function f of x of radius half, then you have to draw the curve parallel to this curve but a half distance above. You see at all these points the distance is half. Similarly this side also distance is half. Okay, now you draw any curve which is in between these two lines, all those functions will have distance half, distance at most half from this function, okay. So maybe if you are seeing it for the first time, maybe it is a little bit abstract, so but we will see many problems also that later it will make better sense to you. So similarly, if suppose this is my function f, then for this function again I want to understand the open ball of radius epsilon, then from this function I draw another function from of distance epsilon. So you see this function, that another function is also has the same shape as like f, because at every point the corresponding point should be at the distance epsilon away, okay. So for example, this point is corresponds to this point and the distance should be epsilon, this point is corresponds to this point and the distance is epsilon. So some kind of like whatever the shape of this curve, then this f plus epsilon and f minus epsilon function also looks like f, only it will be stay above and below. Now you draw any function between these two curves, okay. So like for example this black color curve, that will be within the epsilon radius of this curve f of x, okay. So I will share the notes, you try to understand what is going on, okay. So okay, so we try to understand the convergence in this metric space. Actually we are going to prove that convergence in this metric space is exactly the uniform convergence we see in the real analysis, okay. So if you want to say a sequence of function is converges to a function f, then given a epsilon greater than 0, you have to draw this epsilon neighborhood of this function f such that then you can find a stage n naught such that after the stage the sequence of fn naught plus 1 everything will be lies inside the epsilon neighborhood of the function f, okay. So that is the convergence in this C01 with respect to the infinity now, okay. And if you want to visualize uniform convergence, this convergence is exactly same as uniform convergence, okay. So a sequence of function fn converges to a f uniform convergent if given a epsilon greater than 0, you form this epsilon neighborhood. So epsilon neighborhood means, so any you collect all functions which lies between these two green color functions, and so that is the neighborhood of that point. So there exists a stage n naught such that maybe I'll write here, given epsilon greater than 0, there exists n naught belongs to n such that fn belongs to open ball center at f of radius epsilon for all n greater than or equal to n. So this is the definition of uniform convergence. So you can visualize, okay, we know what is the epsilon neighborhood, and we say that fn tends to f uniformly converges if this condition is satisfied. This is what geometrically means, okay. So let's see, but for in the real analysis book we have seen a different definition for uniform convergence. Usually they don't use this infinite metric, so let's see that definition, okay. Maybe we can get back to, okay, we'll see some examples of this convergence in this C01 with respect to this infinity metric. So fn tends to f if given epsilon greater than 0, you can find a stage such that after this stage, every point in the sequence belongs to this epsilon neighborhood of the function f. Okay. So for example, I take fn of x equal to 1 by n. It means that this 1 by n is not a number. This is a constant function 1 by n. So this is constant function 1 by n. Then we claim that this sequence of functions, constant functions 1 by n, converges to the constant function 0 in the infinity d infinity metric. Okay, so let's visualize it. Like for 1, you get constant function 1. For 2, you get constant function 1 by 2, constant function 1 by 3, 1 by 4, and it keeps going towards the 0 function. Okay, and so now I want to show that this sequence of function converges to this function in this d infinity metric. So let epsilon greater than 0 be given. You take an epsilon. So then now you see that the limit function is the 0 function. So what is how the graph of 0 function looks like in the interval close 0 comma 1? So this is the graph of limit function, 0 function. If you draw epsilon neighborhood, note that epsilon neighborhood is drawn such a way that it is parallel to this, it is similar to this curve, and it is at the distance epsilon. Okay, so now this is my epsilon neighborhood of my limit function. So what I need to do, I have to find a stage n naught such that after that stage, every point in the every fn should lies within this neighborhood. Okay, but that is easy, because since 1 by n sequence converges to 0, you can find a stage such that after that stage, since 1 by n tends to 0, given epsilon greater than 0, there exists n naught belongs to n such that 1 by n less than epsilon, that you can find. So modulus of 1 by n minus 0 less than epsilon, that is basically means 1 by n less than epsilon. So after this, so 1 by n sequence converges to 0, so you get a stage from the number six. We're going to use the same stage here also. So if you look at the sequence fn naught or fn naught plus 1 and all the other sequences, that will be constant function. So again, we need for all n greater than or equal to n naught, we have this condition since 1 by n converges to 0. So after this n naught, all these constant functions 1 by n will come inside this epsilon neighborhood of the function 0. Okay. So this is the simplest example to understand this convergence in the D infinity. So in particular, the sequence of function converges to 0 uniformly also. That we will see. So I hope it is clear. So there is a stage after which 1 by n less than epsilon. 1 by n less than epsilon means that this 1 by n will be here. Therefore, the constant function 1 by n will be here. So 1 by n naught, 1 by n naught plus 1, everything after that will be, all the constant function will be here only. In particular, they are lying within the epsilon radius, epsilon open ball of the function 0. Okay. So any function lying here between these two lines belongs to the epsilon neighborhood. Okay. In particular, all these lines belongs to the epsilon neighborhood. Okay. Okay. So let's continue. So I have given some more examples, so you please have a look at it. So let's look at fn of x equal to x power n. Then let's see what we claim, that this x power n is not converges. We claim that fn does not converges to the constant function 0 in the d infinity metric. Okay, so if fn converges to 0, then for a given a epsilon, so again we claim that the limit function, I take it to be 0 function, and I have drawn the epsilon neighborhood. So if fn converges to 0, then I can find a stage. After that stage, all these functions, see this fn of x equal to x power n look like this. So yeah, f of x, for n equal to 1, you get f of x equal to x. This is this curve. Then for 2, you get f of x equal to x square, then x cube, then x power 4, it keep going like this. Okay, so this function at 0, it is 0, at 1, it is 1. So like it going to be keep going like this only. So in particular, at no time it will come inside this line because it is always going towards 1. Okay, so therefore you cannot put it, you cannot find a stage such that after which this sequence of function is coming inside this neighborhood. Therefore, the sequence of function fn is not converges to 0 in the infinity metric. Okay, so that is one reason. Okay, so let's see why the convergence in this infinity metric is equivalent to the uniform convergence. Okay, so fn tend to f in this infinity metric if and only if given a greater than 0 there exists a stage such that distance between fn comma f is less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to n naught. This is a matrix based definition. So if and only if the supremum itself is less than epsilon, then each of these numbers is less than epsilon. Therefore, given epsilon greater than 0, there exists n naught belongs to n such that modulus of fn of x minus f of x less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to n naught. Since supremum is less than epsilon, this quantity is less than epsilon for all x belongs to close 0 comma 1. Okay, so this is the precise definition of uniform convergence given in any real analysis book. Okay, so we say that fn tend to f uniformly if given epsilon greater than 0, there exists n naught belongs to n such that modulus of fn of x minus epsilon less f of x less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to n naught for all x belongs to close 0 comma 1. But the same definition you can think of in terms of metric spaces also in the C01 with respect to infinity. Now there you have nice diagram to visualize things. So that is what I thought. Okay, so now let's try.
Sir, one doubt, sir.
Hello. Yeah, please.
Sir, here you have told us that that supremum norm must be like if and only if condition for the uniform continuous functions, right?
Right. Yeah.
So that could be for any functions, right?
Anyway, we need a boundedness, right, to define this quantity.
So that means if I in the previous case we have taken the continuous functions, right?
Continuous function close to the common.
So if I want to relax the condition, so I can go only till the boundedness for the definition of this, right?
Right, exactly. So wherever this infinity metric definition makes sense, at all those places we can argue like this using the epsilon balls around the functions f.
Okay, so in the bounded, like in the bounded space, space of functions, space of bounded functions, this every function is converges to a limit uniformly, right? Sequence of functions,
right? No, if it is converges in the infinite norm, then it is converges uniformly also, and conversely. If it is converges uniformly, then it is converges in the infinity metric also. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so, yeah, sure. So, let's look at... hello?
Yeah, sorry to interrupt, sir. One small doubt.
No problem.
After n naught, so supposing I find an n naught given it uniformly converges, can finitely many points, finitely many x such that fn of x does not lie in that epsilon neighborhood, or should everything be inside?
No, this for all x is compulsory. That you cannot relax. For example, we will see an example if you look at this fn of x equal to x power. Okay, I'll answer this question with this example. Okay, your question. Yeah, so we claim that, so we already saw that this fn of x and fn of x equal to x n is not uniformly converges to the function f of x in close 0 comma 1. We proved that x power n is not converges uniformly to 0 function. So now we see what is the point-wise limit of this function fn of x equal to x power n. Okay, so how to how to find the point-wise limit of a sequence of function? That is very easy. So basically, our function is defined on close 0 comma 1. So you take a point from here. So you take a point, say x naught, and you substitute x naught here. Then you let n tend to infinity. So now once you fix a x naught, this is a number sequence, x naught to power n, where n is varying. It is a number sequence. Then you let limit n tend to infinity. That will be, we define it to be f of x naught. So for example, let's do here. So you take any point in close 0 comma 1. Okay. First I take points belongs to close 0, open 1, okay, and I substitute that point x here, okay. So now fn of x, this will be x power n, and then I apply limit n tend to infinity, okay. Note that this x is a fixed number from close 0 comma 1, x is not varying. So for any fixed number belongs to close 0, open 1, this limit n tend to infinity fn of x, this number is defined to be f of x. For the same fixed x, we call the limit of this sequence if it exists. Sometimes this limit may not be exist for some x, okay. So limit n tend to infinity fn of x, we define it to be f of x, and if x belongs to close 0, open 1, then x power n converges to 0 if x belongs to close 0, open 1. That we have seen in the number sequence, okay. So for simple ways to see is like summation x power n, the geometric series converges if and only if mod x is less than 1, okay. So if this series is converges means its nth term should converges to 0, okay. A series converges, summation an converges means that summation an converges means an should goes to 0. So x power n converges to 0 in close 0, open 1 because of mod x less than 1 condition. So you take any point in this interval and you fix that point here, then this will be x power n for that fixed x. Then you let limit n tend to infinity for that fixed x, you will get 0. Therefore, I define a new function, the limit, point wise limit of this sequence to be f of x, that is equal to 0 if x belongs to close 0, open 1. And so if fn is a function from close 0 comma 1, it is limit f is also a function on close 0 comma 1. Now we know f for the interval close 0, open 1. So we have to know what is f of 1. So we substitute 1 in place of x and you let n goes to infinity. So limit n tend to infinity 1 power n, that is 1. So f of x equal to 0 if x belongs to close 0, open 1. 1 if x equal to 1. So this function which takes 0 everywhere except to 1, this is the point wise limit of this sequence of functions x power n, okay. Now like if you note that this is a sequence of continuous functions, fn of x equal to x power n, I mean these are a polynomial, so they are continuous functions and this is its point wise limit. But if you draw the diagram of this function, you will see that this is not a continuous function. Therefore, point-wise limit of a continuous function need not be continuous. This is an example. So we claim that this convergence is not uniform. So maybe like immediately what, if you have already seen some uniformly convergence and all, like we know that if fn is a sequence of continuous function and it is continuous, converges uniformly to a continuous, sorry, if it is converges uniformly to a function f, then the limit function also has to be continuous. But here the limit function is not continuous, therefore the convergence is cannot be uniform because this is a continuous function, this function is not continuous. That is the simplest argument, but we haven't seen the proof or we haven't discussed why the if a sequence of continuous function converges uniformly converges to another function f, then the limit function has to be continuous. That we haven't encountered at all. We have just to see the definition of uniform convergence, right? So we just use the definition and we try to prove that why fn of x equal to f power n is not uniformly converges to this function f of x. That way we will get the better understanding of the definition. So we assume suppose it is uniform, converges uniformly, we get a contradiction, okay. So again the idea is if you, this x power n, it is connecting 0 and 1. So as x tends to if you go towards 1, this is my 1, all this function x power n is going to 1. So if you use that geometric fact, then the proof is immediate. Let's see how to use it. So suppose it is uniform and I take epsilon to be half. So if it is uniformly continuous, what it means, I can find a stage n naught belongs to n such that modulus of fn of x minus f of x is less than epsilon for all n greater than or equal to n naught and for all x belongs to close 0. This is the definition, okay. So This is true for all close 0, 1. In particular, it is true for all x belongs to close 0, open 1 also. I want to put close 0, open 1 because at all these points, close 0, open 1, f of x is 0, right? So that is some, so 0 is easy to deal with. So we get their axis n naught belongs to n such that mod, so now this x power n for close 0 comma 1, this is a non-negative number only, right? So we don't need modulus, and f of x is going to be 0 in close 0 comma 1. So this statement implies that their axis n naught belongs to n such that x power n less than 1 by 2 for all x belongs to close 0 open 1 for all n greater than or equal to n naught. So it says that, so here itself is a, we got a contradiction. So you can find a stage, after that stage, the image of all the functions x power n will be at most 1 by 2. That is what this statement is saying. Okay. So, but if you look at the graph, you can clearly say, see that everything is, so this is say half. You see that every function is going beyond half. Right. So that is not true. Anyway, we'll go one more step to understand this is true. So there is a state such that after that state, x power n is less than 1 by 2 for all x belongs to close 0, open 1. Right. Now, so in particular, this is true for this, this number n naught. So x power n naught less than 1 by 2 for all x belongs to close 0, open 1. Okay. But now, so this x power n naught, you apply limit extends to... So you apply limit extends to 1. So limit extends to 1, x power n naught, this is equal to 1. Okay, because this is a polynomial. So you'll get 1 power n naught, that is basically 1. Therefore, limit extends to 1, this quantity is goes to 1. It means that this function x power n naught, that can go to close to 1 as much as possible. Okay, but we are saying that this is less than 1 by 2. That is not... That is a contradiction. Okay. So again, the same reason is x power n naught, fn. So this fn naught of x, this is equal to x power n naught. This is one function in this sequence. This sequence also looks like this only, like it will start from 0 and it will increase to 1. So, but we are saying that at all the points, in close 0, 1, we are saying that it is less than half. That is not true. Okay. Yeah. Because when you go close to 1, this function is going close to 1. That is the reason. Okay. So we get a contradiction. Therefore, the sequence of function xn power n is not converges to its pointless limit uniformly. Okay. So this is one argument. This will be useful in other problems also. Okay. So maybe this function. Okay. This is a very important problem. So we'll see that. So you look at fn from R to R, I look at fn of x equal to x power n, okay? Now, so if you let x tends to infinity, then x will goes to infinity, okay? And if you let x tends to, do I need all those things? No, I don't need any of this, sorry. We don't need any of this. So how to find the point-wise limit? Okay, this may be a little confusing, let me erase it, we don't need it. I was trying to give some different arguments, so I wrote all these things. So fn of x equal to x power n, how to find the point-wise limit? So point-wise limit is f of x. So you take a x belongs to R arbitrary, I want to understand what is f of x. By definition, f of x equal to limit n tend to infinity fn of x. This is the point-wise limit definition. So you fix a x, you put it in fn and you find the limit n tend to infinity. Okay. So if I fix a x, then I let n tend to infinity, I get this quantity goes to 0. Whatever x, whatever real number x, once it is fixed, it is a constant. So n goes to infinity, we get x by n goes to 0. Therefore, this sequence of function fn converges to the constant function 0 point wise. So this is a point wise limit. So to prove, we are claiming that this sequence of function is not converges uniformly to the function 0. So let's see why. We don't need, do we need epsilon greater than 0 given? No. This is also, we don't need. So we assume, so if you look at the graph of the function, it will be like this. For f1, f2, f3, it will be like this. Yeah, again, we don't need, I'm not going to prove geometrically, so we don't need any of these things. Yeah. So, suppose we assume that, suppose Fn tend to 0 uniformly, then we get a contradiction. Okay. So, this is a very, very important technique. So, this will be very useful in many problems. So, let's try to understand. So, if I substitute n, okay, note that we are looking at the functions from R to R. Always, whenever you're doing a problem related to sequence of functions, always see what is the domain. Okay, codomain is also fine, irrelevant, but the domain is very, very important. So, in particular, the points n, natural numbers, are belongs to R. If I am working with, if I'm working in closed zero comma one, then I can, this argument will not work. Okay, for example, the same sequence of function, fn of x equal to x power n, it is actually uniformly converges to zero function in the interval closed zero comma one. So this is the argument I have given here. I will share the notes, you can look at it. Okay, so the same sequence of function, its behavior changes if you change the domain. That is a very important fact. There is a question in which they keep changing the domain and they ask whether the convergence is uniform or not. So convergence is depends on the domain also. That is the one thing to remember. Now, so suppose fn tend to 0 uniformly, then I look at fn of n. So fn of n is 1 for all n. Okay. So if you can find a point in the domain such that fn of that point is equal to one fixed scalar, then that sequence of function is not going to converge uniformly. Okay, so let's see why. That is basically because that just follows from the definition of uniform convergence. Okay, let me explain in the proof. So again, so this quantity is 1. So I take something epsilon less than this constant value. Okay, that is our idea. So we assume, suppose fn tend to the its point wise limit 0. Okay, so always you can find the point wise limit. So suppose the point is fn tend to its point wise limit uniformly. So then, so I take epsilon equal to 1/2. Then there exists n naught such that now the limit function is 0 function. So I didn't put a 0. So modulus of fn of x less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to n naught for all x belongs to R. So note that the modulus of fn of x minus f of x, since the limit function is 0, I didn't put the limit function. So fn of x equal to x power n. Okay. So for epsilon equal to 1/2, we get this quantity, this result for all x belongs to R. Okay. So in particular, for this n naught, okay, we get modulus of x by n naught strictly less than 1/2 for all x belongs to R. Okay, in particular, so it says that this x by n naught is a bounded function. Okay, but if you look at the graph of this functions x by n, all of them are, so f of x equal to ax plus b, this is a line, right? It is an infinite line. Okay. So in particular, like if you look at f of x equal to some x by 100, this is also a straight line joining 0 and 1/10. Okay, so all this, any linear polynomials are infinite lines in R2. Okay, therefore, like this, but we get this function fn of x equal to fn naught of x equal to x by n naught is bounded. That is what we are getting. So this implies that fn naught of x equal to x by n naught. This function is bounded. That is a contradiction. Or in other words, so this is true for all x belongs to R. So in particular, this is true for n naught also. Okay, so if you substitute x equal to n naught, you get 1 less than 1/2. So that is another problem. Okay, so
sir, how to assume, sir?
Work whenever,
sir? Hello, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, suppose you are assuming, suppose fn converges to 0 uniformly, that point is fixed, sir. How to assume that one, sir?
like we you, saw no the limit point limit is zero because you fixed a point x. Okay, then x by so you fix a point x and it will let n tend to infinity, you will get a zero. Okay, therefore that is the limit function. Okay.
Okay.
Just only 1 minute.
Sir,
hello.
In the previous question, where x power n, can I remove the point one because that causes that seems it causes the problem here, right?
Okay.
So can I remove the point x equals to one from the domain? Then it's going to be uniformly convergent, is it?
So I thought I'll put it as an exercise and maybe like I will let you guys try for a day or so. And maybe if nobody come with the answer, maybe I'll share the answer tomorrow in the WhatsApp group.
In the same similar question, I'm going to ask with this with the next thing, like if I remove all the integer points from the R, right? It will be going to, again,
that is not alone the problem. There are more problems. So removing that alone won't be sufficient.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So, like, but I think it is very straightforward to check. Like, you just sit and write down the definition of uniform continuity, it will be fine. Like, removing the integers alone is not going to make that sequence of function uniform. Yeah. Okay. So, we have a this is the, now I'm stating the result formally. Suppose fn is a sequence of functions from a set E to R and a fn tend to f uniformly. And each fn's are continuous function, then the limit function is also continuous. Okay. Okay. So note that continuous point-wise limit does not imply that the convergence is uniform. So it means that suppose fn is a sequence of continuous function and it is converges to a continuous function. Okay. So if it is converges to a discontinuous function, then definitely the convergence is not uniform. But suppose it is converges to a continuous function, point wise converges to a continuous function, then can we say the convergence is uniform? No, that we cannot say. So like a sequence of continuous functions can have continuous limit without having uniform convergence. For example, we can take the same example, fn of x equal to x by n, and then each of them are continuous function and the limit function 0 is also a continuous function, but convergence is not uniform. Okay, so you try to understand this note. It looks very simple, but there are some problems. Yes, problems also asked using this this particular point. Okay, yeah, so let's continue. Yeah, so xn is not, fn to the x power n is not uniform because the limit function is not continuous. Okay. Okay, so suppose fn tend to f, say point wise or uniformly in any way, doesn't matter. And we assume that fn's are continuous and the limit function f is also continuous. Okay. Now, let's fix a point a belongs to e. Okay. Then, since fn tends to f, limit n tends to infinity, fn of x equal to f of x. Okay. So, now, in both the sides, we take the limit x tends to a. What we'll get? So, limit x tends to a, limit n tends to infinity, fn of x equal to limit x tends to a, f of x. Okay. Now, what we can do? First, you consider fn of x, okay? In fn of x, first you apply limit x tends to a fn of x, okay? I think I have to show the pointer will be better, but only 1 minute. This charge has gone down. I think now it is a little bit charged, I think. Yeah, so what I'm doing here is, so suppose fn tend to f, that means that limit n tend to infinity fn of x equal to f of x, because f is a point wise limit. Now what I'm doing is in fn of x, first I'm applying limit n tend to infinity. Okay, so that will give me f of x. Then I apply limit x tends to a, so that will give me limit x tends to a f of x. Okay, now similarly, instead of first apply limit n tend to infinity fn of x, I'm applying limit x tends to a. Okay, so limit x tends to a fn of x will give me fn of a, because since fn is our continuous functions, so a function is continuous, so this is the limit definition of continuous functions we saw in the first lecture. So a function is continuous at the point a, if limit x tends to a, f of x equal to f of a. Okay, so we get limit x tends to a fn of x equal to fn of a. Now first I apply this limit x tends to a, I got fn of a. Then I apply limit n tends to infinity, therefore I have to apply limit n tends to infinity to this quantity. Now limit n tends to infinity fn of a will be f of a. Okay, therefore, so you see limit n tends to infinity fn of x equal to f of x, therefore limit n tends to infinity fn of a will be f of a by the definition of point wise limit. Therefore this interchanges of limit are equal if, so I have changed the limit order of the limit. First I am applying limit n tends to infinity, then I am applying limit x tends to a. Here I am doing the other way. So these two limits are equal if these two quantities are equal. So limit x tends to a f of x equal to f of a, you will get only when f is a continuous function. Okay, so if f is a continuous function, then you will get these two limits are equal. Limit x tends to a, limit n tends to infinity fn of x is equal to limit n tends to infinity limit x tends to a fn of x. Okay, so that is when you can interchange a limit, that sort of questions are there in the previous year exam. So if the limit function is continuous, basically you can
Here we just need f to be continuous at x is equal to a. If we like, we do not need to be continuous domain.
So here I'm using only limit x tends to a. So for that limit, it is enough that f is continuous at the point a. But usually we change these points. So this is an arbitrary point. A is an arbitrary point in E. So if you want to interchange this limit for arbitrary a, then this function should be continuous at every point. Okay. Anyway, so it is just a minor remark. There are some problems related to interchanging the limits. That is why. But in general, limits cannot be interchanged. Okay, so let's see one quick example. Like I define I think it's called double sequence or something. Double sequence, I think. Let's call it double sequence. So a m comma n. So usually we look at sequence a n. Only n will varies. But here I have two indices, m and n. So a m comma n will be m by m plus n. So first I let limit n tend to infinity. Okay, so if you let limit n tend to infinity here, that means that you fix a m, then limit n tend to infinity, this will goes to zero after, so this is become zero, then limit m tend to infinity zero is zero. Okay, so the other way, first you let limit m tend to infinity, so limit m tend to infinity, since this n is constant, one can prove that this is sequence is counted to one. Okay, this limit is one. Okay, for any constant here. Therefore, this is one means the limit n tends to infinity constant sequence one is one. Okay, so in general, this is one very simple but important example. Sometimes they ask in interview also why you cannot interchange the limits. Okay, in general you cannot interchange the limits. Okay, this Riemann integration, differentiation, continuity, everything depends on limit only, right? So Riemann integration also limit of the upper sums, limit of the lower sums. So everything is limit. So when you compose two things like uniform convergence, there will be a limit n tend to infinity. Then if you look at the derivative, there will be a limit. So can you interchange those two limits? So in general, you cannot. So that kind of argument. Anyway, so this is one minor remark. So next, pretty much I have about 25 minutes. So I have a lot of problems to cover. Let's go quickly. So if fn is a sequence of unbounded functions, but the point-wise limit can be bounded. Okay, so a sequence of unbounded functions can converge to a function. Again, you look at the sequence of function x by n. Okay, so we saw that the x by n are all the functions are like infinite, right? They are all unbounded functions. So fn of x, each fn is an unbounded function because they are all straight line. But the limit function is zero function. Okay, so sequence of unbounded function can converge. Can converge point-wise to a bounded function. So this goes to zero, which is a bounded function. So that the again a simple remark. Again, like a sequence of bounded function can point-wise converge to an unbounded function. For example, you consider fn of x equal to x square. So if x belongs to minus n comma n and zero elsewhere. Okay, as n tend to infinity, this minus n comma n is going to keep enlarging. As n tend, when n goes to infinity, this minus n comma n will become minus infinity comma infinity. So this limit function will be actually f of x equal to x square. Oh, I think I gave a wrong example, right? Bounded, but the point is limit. Ah, yeah, I'm fine, right? So each fn is a bounded function because this is a compact set and it is a continuous function. So it is bounded. Everywhere else, it is zero only. So it is a... Each fn is a bounded function, but the limit is a x square from R to R. So f of x equal to x square as a function from R to R, it's an unbounded function. Okay. So again, this all happens only if the convergence is point wise. Okay. If you go to point uniform convergence, these kind of things cannot happen. Okay. But these things won't happen if fn tend to f point wise uniform. Sorry, if fn tend to f uniformly. So again, just a remark, you try to give a rigorous proof, or you can look at any. Like any standard real analysis textbook. Okay. So, in this example, if you look at the graph of fn of x equal to, if you look at the graph of this function, in minus n to n, it is x square. Everywhere else, it is zero. So, if you draw the graph of this function, you will see that this is a discontinuous function. Okay, it is discontinuous at minus n and plus n. At these two points, it is discontinuous, but it is converges to a, it is point wise converges to a continuous function. Okay. So we saw that sequence of bounded function can go converges to a unbounded function. Sequence of unbounded function can converge to a bounded function. This can be avoided if the convergence is uniform. Similarly, now if we have an example of sequence of discontinuous function, which is converges to a continuous function. Now the question is, can you avoid this by assuming the convergence is uniform? So in other words, suppose fn is a sequence of some discontinuous function and fn tend to f uniformly, then f also discontinuous at some points, whether this is true or false, and the answer is false. Okay, so this is not preserved under uniform continuity. So this is a very important example. Like you take fn of x to be 1 by n if x belongs to rational numbers, 0 if x is irrational. Okay, you can define this function in R to R also, no problem. Then the limit function, point-based limit, will be zero function under the see this each fn is nowhere continuous because like these are all like Dirichlet functions, like, so we know that the example of a nowhere continuous function is Dirichlet function. So nowhere continuous. In other, similarly, this function also nowhere continuous, very very badly discontinuous. Even there is no single point at which this function is continuous, but the limit function is continuous. Okay, so and the convergence is uniform, very importantly. So uniform limit of a discontinuous function can be continuous. That is one remark. Okay, so let's do some more problems. So fn of x equal to sine x by n. I'll discuss the convergence. That is a problem. I think domain is R to R. Okay, I have written here. Domain is R, codomain is R. So clearly the point is limit is zero, because if you put a x, fix a x, then you let n tend to infinity, this is goes to zero, sine zero is zero. Okay, therefore the point-wise limit is a zero function for every x belongs to R. Now, as I said before, if you substitute n here in place of x, if you substitute n, fn of n will be sine 1. So this is a positive number. Okay, so I think sine 1 is a positive number. Yes, sine 1 is a positive number. Yeah, we just need a non-zero number. Non-zero number will do. So this is a sine 1 is a non-zero number. So once fn of some number is a constant for all n, note that this is true. This is true for all n. Once it is a constant for all n, then this convergence cannot be uniform. Again, we recall that we use the same idea to prove fn of x equal to x power n is not uniform, because fn of n equal to 1. Now we got fn of n equal to sine 1. So basically you take a epsilon which is less than that quantity, sine 1, then you will get the contradiction. Okay, the same, along the same lines you will get the contradiction. So like always trying to see, can you substitute one number such that the fn of that quantity is a constant, then the convergence is not uniform. Okay, so fn not tends to zero uniformly. Now let's do fn of x equal to 1 by n sin nx. So then again, for the same reason, like fn tends to zero point wise, because this is bounded, like it is at most 1. As n tends to infinity, this limit will be 0. So fn tend to 0 point wise. So because like if you look at mod fn of x, mod fn of x equal to mod sine nx divided by n. So this is less than or equal to 1 by n, because modulus of sine x is less than or equal to 1. So modulus of fn of x is less than or equal to 1 by n means that fn of x converges to 0 point wise. So now we claim that convergence is uniform. So let the epsilon greater than 0 be given. So we're going to prove the convergence is uniform actually. The sequence of function converges to 0 uniformly. So let epsilon greater than 0 be given. I find the value of modulus of fn of x minus f of x. But f of x is 0. So I haven't written f of x here. So modulus of fn of x equal to modulus of 1 by n sine nx. And this is less than or equal to 1 by n. Like similar to the similar argument, because this is less than or equal to 1. Right, now therefore this is less than or equal to 1 by n means, since 1 by n sequence converges to 0, what you can do, you can find a stage such that after that stage the sequence 1 by n will be less than epsilon. So so this 1 by n less than epsilon means that the modulus of 1 by n minus 0 is less than epsilon. So since 0 is the limit, you get there exists a stage after which modulus of 1 by n minus 0 less than epsilon, but that basically means that 1 by n less than epsilon. Okay, so this, now there is a stage after which 1 by n less than epsilon, but the modulus of fn of x is less than 1 by n. So this quantity will also less than epsilon. So we get there exists a stage such that modulus of fn of x less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to n naught, because of this inequality, and this argument is independent of x. So for all x, we get modulus of fn of x less than epsilon for all n greater than equal to n naught. Okay, therefore the convergence is uniform. Again, so if you can bound this quantity by a sequence converges to 0, then the convergence is uniform. That is our next result. So fn be a sequence of functions from a set E to R, and fn tend to f point wise, we define this number an, a number sequence, to be supremum x belongs to E, modulus of fn of x minus f of x. Okay, so this is not norm, this is just a modulus. We define this number like this, then fn tend to f uniformly if and only if an converges to the sequence an converges to 0. Okay, so I'll skip the proof. Proof is just two lines. It is just immediate. So let's use this result to prove the uniform convergence. So f is equal to 1 by n cos nx. So again, the same argument. So you can check it. I'll share the notes. So we saw 1 by n sin nx, the cos nx also same argument. You can check. So now we can move on to solving some problems of the CSR exam. So let me take some water. So many times, if you can visualize the sequence, given sequence of functions, then the answer will follow immediately. So this is one example of such problem. So it is asking in the last year, 2019 December only, the last CSIR exam, this problem is asked. So usually they try to scare us with like a lot of these kind of things. Okay, so cos, mx and all like, and it is split into three different ranges. Okay, and the function is given on over. So the domain of each sequence of function is 1 by n. We have seen the functions from close 0, 1 and functions from R to R, 0, 1 to R. These are the things we saw. But suddenly we are looking at functions from the set 1 by n. So, but if we have the concept clear in our mind, yeah, you just use the concept what we know, then the answer is immediate. Okay, so it is a part B problem. So technically, you cannot spend more than 2-3 minutes. Worst the case, 5 minutes, okay? 5 minutes is itself is too much for a part B problem. So let's see how to understand this problem. So it is given that the domain of the function is 1 by n sequence. So 1 by 2, then 1 by 3, 1 by 4. And so this sequence is going and it converges to 0. So here you will see a lot of points here. So only these points is the domain of our function. Okay. Let's see how the function is defined. So whenever this for arbitrary m, the function is defined. To understand the function, you take m to be some fixed value. Okay, I take m to be 10. And let's see how the function is defined. So fm of x equal to cos mx if x greater than or equal to 1 by m. 0 for x lies between 1 by m plus 10 and 1 by m. If x less than or equal to 1 by m plus 10. This is what is given. I take m to be 10. Okay, so this 10 and the 10 I am using may be a little confusing, but I just randomly took 10. I didn't notice there is another 10. Okay, fine, let's see. So if x greater than or equal to 1 by m, then the image is cos mx. Okay, so if x is greater than or equal to 1 by 10, then image is cos mx, right? So if you look at this sequence 1 by n, it is decreasing, right? So what are all the elements x in the set E such that x is greater than or equal to 1 by m? So that those points are precisely these points, which are lying in the right side of 1 by 10, okay? So the points x such that x greater than or equal to 1 by m is precisely the points in the set E which are lying to the right side of 1 by m. Okay. So to the right side of 1 by m, we have cos mx. Okay. So at all these points, we have to calculate cos mx. Okay. So I just plot some points because see, the domain is a discrete set. So this is 1 by 10, 1 by 9, 1 by 8, 1 by 7, 1 by 6, 1 by 5, and so on. Okay. So after 1 by 10, these are my points. And at all these points, I have marked the images. So clearly, it is not a continuous function like because the domain itself is disconnected. So, I mean, it is the curve you cannot draw continuously because of the nature of the domain. And next, so this part we are done. Next, come to this part. Between 1 by m plus 10 and 1 by m, the image is 0. So we took m to be 10. So between 1 by 20 to 1 by 10, the image is 0. So this is the points lying between 1 by 10 and 1 by 20. Here the image is, so whatever points 1 by n lying between 1 by 10 and 1 by 20, the image is 0. Therefore, 0 means we have to just plot the point here. Then any point less than or equal to n by m plus 10, the image is x, the identity function. So for all the points lying to the left of this 1 by m plus 10, here you're going to have the identity function. But identity function also, it won't be continuous because here the points are not continuous. Okay, so whichever point you have, the image will be itself. So here it will be like a constant function, but with a lot of dots. Okay. So this is the structure. This is how fm of x looks like. Okay. So after 1 by m, it is will be looks like cos mx. Okay. Not continuous. It will be look like cos mx. And between 1 by m plus 10 to 1 by m, it will be zero function. Then after 1 by m plus 10, here it will be lot of dots, but identity function. Dots on the identity function. This is how the graph looks like. Now we want to understand the point-wise limit. Which of the following statements is true? No subsequences of fm converges at every point of e. Every subsequences of fm converges at every point of e. There exists infinitely many subsequences which converges at every point of e. There exists a subsequence which is converges to zero at every point of e. These are the four options. Basically, they are asking about only point-wise convergence. So we understand point-wise convergence. So what happens is, when this m goes to infinity, this point 1 by m. So in our example, this is our 1 by m. Okay. So after 1 by m, this is going to be looks like cos mx. Between 1 by m and 1 by m plus 10, it will be looks like zero function. Then this side, it will be looks like identity function, right? As m tend to infinity, what happens is this 1 by m is going to move towards left. Okay, it actually comes to zero. So what happens is, this cos mx is going to come, it's going to come in more and more. So here, cos mx coming only this part, right? So then it will come in for m equal to 11, it will come this part from 1 by 11 to 1. So as m goes to infinity, 1 by m goes to move to the left. If 1 by m is moved to the left, after 1 by m, you have the graph cos mx. So the graph of cos mx going to come to more and more points to this side. Okay. So as m tends to infinity, 1 by m will go to 0. So at the limiting case, this function won't be there. This function won't be there. Only this cos mx will survive. Actually, this sequence of function converges to cos mx on the set E. Okay. So that is our geometric understanding. As m tends, so after 1 by m, you have cos mx. But as m tends to infinity, these regions will be empty. Okay. Because this will be like very too small. But as m tends to infinity, this will be empty set. It will be, there won't be many points here. And this goes to 0. So these two functions won't be appear at all. As m tends to infinity, only this function will remain. That is the point-wise limit. Okay. So again, you try to understand what is happening here. Try to visualize it. Okay, so we haven't proved it, but that is the answer. So if so this function converges to this cos mx point wise to every point, therefore this option is wrong. If fn tends to f point wise, then every subsequent also goes to f point wise, like in the number sequence. So the no subsequence converges at every point of e is wrong. Every subsequence converges at every point of E is correct, because fm itself is converges to f point wise, means every subsequence will converges to f at every point. There exists infinitely many subsequence which converges at every point of E. So this is also true, but we have to choose the best in part B. So best option will be every subsequence converges at every point of E. Okay, so now I start to feel little I'm a little bit confused, but everybody please go through this answer and please check, is there any gap I have made? Okay. Then there exists a subsequent which converts zero at every point of E. That is not true, because the limit is not a zero function. Oh, sorry. The limit function is not a zero function, so limit function is cos mx. Okay, yeah, think about the options. We just put that fm converges to cos mx at every point of e. from that we can eliminate the wrong options. That is the idea. So let's continue. Hello, we have a lot of problems to cover. I have about
Told that limit function converges to cos mx, but whenever we take limit, then m should not be there.
That is a good point. Yeah, that is what that is why I was also confused a little bit here. Yeah, that is a very good point. So there should not be m as m tends to infinity. But m tends to infinity cos mx does not exist. So that is precisely the point they are trying to make in this problem. Yeah, that is the mistake I made, I think. So after seeing the answer only, I sense there is some problem. My present understanding is, so limit tends to infinity, we're going to get only cos mx, okay, as m goes to infinity. But limit tends to infinity cos mx cos 1x, cos 2x, cos 3x, and you fix a x. So fix a x, x is of the form 1 by n, and that doesn't exist. So at no points the point is limit exists. Oh, that is true. Okay. So I have to so what I said is wrong. So let's see why. Yeah. So we want to understand point wise limit. So we take x belongs to E, and basically x equal to 1 by n for some n. Okay. Now, what I said is true. As m tend to infinity, finally this cos mx only going to be there for large m. So what I'm trying to say. So if you substitute, we come back to this problem. There is no point in spending a lot of time, but we'll move to the next problem. Yeah. So,
If I can suggest something, see, EN is a compact set. The set E is compact, right?
Right.
So right. When I tend M tends to infinity, the domain for
no cos. Right? No. E is compact. E is not compact. It is not a closed set.
Oh yes, it is. We cannot take it as a discrete.
Right. Yeah. Even if we take it as a discrete, we cannot argue. You try to use continuity argument, right? Limit function is continuous, that kind of. I think that is
also one. So I was trying to bound it this cos mx.
Right. But I think there is some problem with that way also. That's what I'm feeling. Anyway, let's discuss this problem in the group. That is much better because I have a lot more things to cover in 30 minutes. I can cover in 30 minutes. So again, this is 2019 June. So every time CSR exam, one or two problem is asked in sequence of functions or series of functions, and the problems are very easy. Okay, well, we just need to know what is meaning of point-wise convergence, what is meaning of uniformly convergence, then the answer comes immediately. Okay, so there are some problem asked in the NBHM questions. They are little bit more difficult in a sequence of function. For example, the one I shared in the today chat, I have shared one problem. You can check the link in the. So that problem is a little bit more complicated than this, but all the sequence of function problem asked in CSIR are very straightforward. For example, if you look at this function, gn of x equal to nx by 1 plus n square x square in closed interval 0 comma infinity, then you get gn of, whenever this n square coming with x square or n cube coming with x cube, what you can immediately do is you just substitute 1 by n. So what happens is n times 1 by n. So this one x will cancel. So basically we want some constant in the right side to prove function is not uniformly convergent. So you will get a constant if x and n are disappearing, right? So basically n should x and n should cancel each other. We try to do that. So if you substitute x equal to 1 by n, then what we get, this is what we get, right? So basically we get 1 by 2, correct? I think so. 1 by n square, n square cancels 1 by 2. So again, once you got gn of some number equal to fixed constant for all n. So this for all n is what is very important. Then you can, using the same argument we did for fn of x equal to x power n, you can conclude that function is not converges uniformly, but it converges to zero function. Okay, you see, for a fixed x, numerator there is a n, denominator there is n square, therefore limit tends to infinity, this quantity goes to zero for a fixed x, because the denominator there is n square. So therefore the limit, point wise limit is zero, but the convergence is not uniform because of this fact. Okay, so the answer is this is the answer. So sometimes they don't know, like so they know what a two options they set immediately. So remaining two options, they don't know what to set. So they randomly give two answers. Yeah. Anyway, so we know this is clearly. So this problem is fine. We can move on. So pretty much all the problems asked in CSIR using this idea. So this is 2018 December. Sorry, I don't have the clear question. So for n greater than or equal to 1, consider fn of x equal to 1 by 2nx plus 1. Gn of x equal to x by 2nx plus 1. In the interval, open 0 comma 1. Again, note the domain clearly. So then the sequence fn converges uniformly. That is the first statement. And the sequence gn converges to uniformly on open 0 comma 1. So the two statements are given. We have to say which statement is correct, which statement is false. Again, you see n is comes with x. So if you substitute 1 by n for x, that x and n will go away. You get a constant, so you'll get fn is not converges uniformly. Now, if you look at the gn of x, you have you cannot substitute equal to 1. This x will always be there, so you won't get a constant. But let's see what to do. Like so, gn of x equal to x by 2nx plus 1, and x belongs to open 0 comma 1, and you have a n in the denominator, therefore limit is 0. Therefore, point wise limit is 0. Now we want to understand whether the convergence is uniform. Okay, so to prove the convergence is uniform, we have to use that the sequence AN converges to zero, that criterion we will use. So we want to understand supremum modulus of fn of x minus f of x. Okay, x belongs to open 0 comma 1. And in this problem, f of x is 0, limit function, sorry, we are going for a g. So I change it to g. So g of x is 0. So we want to understand supremum modulus of gn of x, okay? So if you know supremum of gn, then you know supremum of mod gn also, okay? So how do you get the supremum of a function? Basically, how do you know the maximum and the minimum of a function? That we learn in calculus, that you have to take the derivative and equate the derivative to zero, you get the there is a name for those points, right? It is called is it called critical points or so the points at which derivative vanishes, is there a name
it's for called those critical points?
Oh, okay, so I'm not really sure whether it is critical points, but let's call it critical.
Stay sorry, yes.
Stationary points, yeah, that is also I have seen. It's also
no critical point. Critical point,
okay. So let's say fix with critical points. So it's called critical points, I think. Anyway, so we find the critical points and see how it behaves. So gn of x equal to x by 2nx plus 1. If you look at the derivative, so you can calculate the derivative. So derivative will be 1 by 2nx plus 1 the whole square, okay. And again, for x belongs to open 0 comma 1, this quantity is a positive quantity, right? So if derivative is positive, then the function is increasing. Then for an increasing function, what will be the maximum? The maximum will be attained at the end point. So even though we are looking at the open intervals, so this function is defined for closed interval also with without any problem. So we are looking at only the supremum. Okay, so for when you're looking at supremum, you can look at the close interval and find the supremum. That will be the supremum of the function in open interval also, because the function is a continuous function. Okay, so these are all continuous functions. Gn of x is sequence of continuous function, right? The derivative is not vanishing at any point. Or derivative is vanishes at some point here. For x equal to minus, for x equal to minus 1 by 2n only derivative vanishes, but minus 1 by 2n is not here. Okay, so it is a sequence of continuous function. So that is fine. So it is an increasing function. So the maximum is attained at the point 1, since the interval is given open 0, 1. So the maximum will be 1 by 2n plus 1. If you substitute 1, I'll get 1 by 2n plus 1. So supremum x belongs to open 0, 1. Mod gn of x will be 1 by 2n plus 1, and this is converges to 0. So note that we saw a criterion, like using this sequence an. So you define to be supremum mod fx minus x, then fn tend to f uniformly if and only if this sequence converges to 0. Yeah, we are using that criterion. So convergence is uniform. Therefore, f is not uniform. G is uniform, sorry, Fn is not uniform, but Gn is converges uniform, so we can choose the option accordingly. Again, like this is a nice problem. 2018 December. Fn sequence of continuous real valued function on close 0, 1, satisfying the following. Fn is decreasing sequence, and the sequence Fn converges uniformly to 0. I define a new series of function. So it is a finite sum only. So gn of x equal to summation k equal to 1 to n minus 1 4 power k fk of x. It is kind of oscillating series kind of thing. See, I'm not going to prove anything. I'm going to state one result. From that, the answer is going to follow. So I won't tell anything about series of functions. So I'll just quote a result. And I'll conclude this problem particularly. So let's see how to approach this problem. First option is Gn is Cauchy with respect to the supnorm. Supnorm is same as that infinity norm we saw, right? The supremum mod fn of x minus f of x. That is what is called supnorm we saw in the beginning of the talk. So they are said that this Gn is a Cauchy sequence, and this Gn is uniformly convergent. This Gn need not converge pointwise. Then this means that this Gn is uniformly bounded. But I think we will not have enough time to cover uniformly bounded. But for this problem, uniformly boundedness, it is easy. If you just look at the definition of what is uniformly boundedness, please check the option 4. Just 1 minute. So this is alternating series test for sequence of numbers. Only 1 minute, let me get some water. An is a sequence of non-negative real numbers satisfying an is decreasing, an tend to 0, then summation, the alternating series summation minus 1 power n, an converges. This is called Leibniz test. So if you look at this problem, the problem is very much similar. Like a sequence of continuous real valued function. So this is a sequence of function analog of Leibniz test. You are given a sequence of functions. It is decreasing. It is converges to 0 uniformly. Then they are asking about the convergence of summation minus 1 whole power and fn. Okay. Yeah. So the result is the same result hold. The same similar analog result for sequence of function hold it true, okay, and the series converges. So how to prove it? Like you look at the proof of Leibniz test for numbers, imitate the same proof, we can prove that this Gn converges uniformly. Okay, again, so we get Gn is uniformly convergent by that result. So this is true. So this option is false. Uniformly bounded, you check using the definition. in this option, gn is Cauchy with respect to the sup norm. That is also true. That is called the Cauchy criterion for uniformly convergence. Okay. So for example, like Cauchy criterion for uniformly convergence. So what, let's see. Let's quickly see what does it mean. So f and t of uniformly. Suppose you consider C 0 1. F and t of uniformly if and only if f and t f in the d infinity metric or in the sup norm. So for another name for d infinity is sup norm. Okay. So f and tend to f in sup norm, if and only if. So it is a metric space. In a metric space, a convergent series is a Cauchy sequence. Therefore, f and is a Cauchy sequence in this metric space. That basically means that given epsilon, we can find a n naught belongs to n stage such that distance between any two points is less than epsilon after that stage. So again, we just put the distance definition. If and only if given epsilon greater than zero, you can find a stage such that supremum mod fn of x minus fm of x less than epsilon for all n greater than or equal to n naught. So supremum is less than epsilon means that for every x, x belongs to close 0 comma 1, this would be close 0 comma 1 because I have taken close 0 comma 1 in the beginning, but for arbitrary e also it works. Sorry. Yeah, so given this is the Cauchy criterion given in the book, okay, and so uniformly converges if and only if Cauchy criterion holds true, but this is true if and only if fn is a Cauchy sequence in the sup norm, okay, so that is what given in the first option, therefore it is true, okay.
Sir,
let's move to the next problem. Hello.
Okay, should I ask right now or after the session? Because it's a time crunch, right?
Yeah. So let's see the problems. I have only a couple of more problems. I think I'll finish within 10 minutes. Yeah, so this is again one more problem. F1 of x equal to x e power minus n x square. So again about uniform convergence. So F1 of x equal to x by e power n x square. So for a fixed x, this 1 by e power n converges to 0. Therefore, for a fixed x, one can prove that like this limit is also goes to 0 for any x. So domain is R, so let's mark it down. X belongs to R. So this goes to 0. Now, to prove uniform convergence, we want to understand supremum modulus of fn of x minus f of x. But the limit function is zero, so we want to understand supremum mod fn of x. So basically, we want to understand maximum of this function fn, right? So we'll use the derivative argument. So if you calculate the derivative of this function x by e power n x square, and if you equate it to zero, you get the points x equal to plus or minus 1 by root 2n. These are the critical points, okay? Then you can see that at the point this 1 by root 2n, we get the maximum of this sequence of function. We get the maximum of the function fn, and the maximum value will be e power minus 1 by 2 times 1 by root n. Okay. So again, you have to go to the second derivative and check whether at this point, so at the critical points, the function might take maximum and a minimum, maximum or minimum. So there are only two values. One is 1 by root 10, another is minus 1 by 2 root 10, right? I don't know. Just, yeah. 1 by 2 root 10, minus 1 by 2 root 10. These are the only two critical points we have. So you substitute these points in the function. So if one value is less than the other value, then the larger value is the maximum, smaller value is the minimum. So this value will be the maximum. Okay, so supremum, x belongs to R. Mod fn of x is e power minus 1 by 2, 1 by root 2n. This converges to 0. So if the supremum goes to 0, that means that the convergence is uniform. Okay, so it is a part B problem, so we don't need to worry about other options. Okay. So again, like the second option is also true. Uniformly convergent. Okay, it says that uniformly convergent only on compact subset. That is not true because even it is converges on R. Okay, so this derivative idea will be very, very useful. Almost all the problems we use this derivative idea only For example, f n of x equal to 1 by 1 plus n square x. Okay, this is a different, like, you get f n of 1 by n equal to 1 by 2. Therefore, the convergence is not uniform. Now, so let's see the other options. So f n converges point-wise on rho 0, comma 1 to a continuous function. That is true because the limit is a zero function. So it's a part C problem. So more than one option can be true. Fn converges uniformly on rho 0, comma 1 is not true because Fn of 1 by n is 1 by 2. Fn converges uniformly on closed interval 1 by 2, comma 1. What is the argument for that? Okay, yeah. So we look at the derivative of this given function Fn. Okay. So this, all these points, all these troubling points. So that this 1 by n is only making problem, right? But if you look at closed interval 1 by 2, comma 1, we don't have that 1 by n. So we can hope that the function is the function might be uniformly continuous. So that's why we're going to check. Okay. So this 1 by n doesn't not belongs to here, doesn't mean that the convergence is uniform. So, but nevertheless, we check. So you look at the derivative, and the derivative is less than 0. For all x, because you have a minus here. So the function is a decreasing function. So if it's a decreasing function, then the maximum is attained at the point 1 by 2, at the left end point, right? Because it's going to decrease like this. So this will be the maximum. So if you substitute 1 by 2 in the function fn of x, you will get, what will you get? Fn of 1 by 2. This is the, well, this is the maximum of the function in the interval, closed interval 1 by 2, comma 1. This is equal to 1 by 1 plus n square by 4. Correct? And yeah, I think I made a calculation mistake. Yeah, basically this is looks like 1 by 1 plus n square, like 1 by 1 plus n square by 4. Doesn't matter. It looks like 1 by 1 plus n square, which goes to 0. Therefore, supremum mod fn of x goes to 0. Therefore, the convergence is uniform. Okay. So, what we conclude is, in the closed interval 1 by 2, comma 1, the convergence is uniform. Now, whether can you interchange the limit and the integration? You see, this is a linear. That is just right away you can check, calculate the integration value, and you apply the limit. And first, so this is zero function, like limit of this point is, limit of this function is zero. So integration is also zero. Now you want to find the integral 0 to 1 fn of x dx. So you calculate the integral of this function. Anybody know what is the integration of this function immediately?
Tan inverse
0 to x. Okay, 1 plus n square, so that you can see as 1 plus nx the whole square dx, correct? So this is equal to tan inverse of nx. Is it
x
correct?
X by n.
X by n, and I should substitute the limit. Sorry, what? Am I making some mistake here? Sorry, I can't hear properly. Hello? So, can you guys hear me? Hello?
Hello? Yes, sir, we can hear you.
So I don't know this integration. What is the answer?
Is it tan inverse of n? No, sir, this is a tan inverse of nx.
Okay, sure. Okay, so should we need to divide by something? No, right? This is tan inverse of nx. First,
into
sure.
By n. By n.
Oh, by
sir, n. Actually, we have to take n square as common. So we will get 1 by n in tan inverse of x by n.
Okay. Okay, so let's not waste more time. So you figure out this integration and you just apply then limit entering to infinity. If the answer is zero, then this option is fourth option is correct. Okay. I'm not immediately see how to do it. Like I'm very bad in integrations and differences. Yeah.
First one is not point wise continuous. It's a false, sir.
Which one
inverse, first derivative of first one, sir.
Fn
converges finally to continuous function. When we apply the limit, first derivative of gn is does not exist, sir.
But why do we need first derivative? That is fine, but this function converges to zero, right?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
This correct.
So point wise limit is zero.
At x is equal to
hello, sir. Yes.
Zero, fn of x converges to one.
Oh,
at
right,
x
right,
is equal
right,
to
right.
Zero, fn of x.
Converges to one, sir. Right. Okay, that is what. Right. That is what he is trying to say. Yeah, that is correct. So f of x, that I didn't notice. Yeah. So for x equal to 0, you get 1. For x equal to 0, everywhere else it is 0. So this is the limit function. So limit function is not continuous. So the, as he pointed out, followed by the madam pointed out, the first option is fn converges point wise and close zero amount to a continuous function is wrong. Correct. Sorry. It's a But I think this is still fine because in closed interval 1 by 2, you don't have 0. So in closed interval 1 by 2, the limit function is indeed a continuous function, 0. So it is fine. So this option, you try to figure it by yourself. And this is a very nice problem. Fn of x equal to minus x power n, x belongs to close 0, comma 1. There exists a point-wise convergence of Okay, let's first figure out what is the point-wise limit of this function. So if you put x equal to 1, then fn of 1 will be minus 1 whole power n. And limit entering to infinity, fn of 1 does not exist because minus 1 whole power n is not a convergent sequence. Therefore, f of 1 is equal to limit entering to fn of 1. But f of 1, if the sequence converges, then only you can define f of 1, okay? So since this sequence does not converge, f of 1 you cannot define. Therefore, in this interval, this sequence of function does not have a point-wise limit, okay? So if the full full sequence does not have a point-wise limit, but the options are there exists a point-wise convergent subsequence. And fn has no point-wise convergent subsequence. Fn converges point-wise everywhere. That is false because at the point 1, you don't have convergence. Fn has exactly one point-wise convergence subsequence. So now we want to understand the subsequences. You see, whenever you have minus 1 whole power n, you have to look at the sequences separately. Even term converges, odd term separately converges. Even term converges to plus 1, minus odd terms converges to minus 1, right? For the sequence minus 1. So we use the same idea here also. So we define a subsequence gn of x equal to f2n of x. Okay, so we are looking at only the even functions, I mean, even term of the sequence fn. Then we get minus x whole power 2n, that is x power 2n. So for this, I get f2, f4, f6, etc. I define a new sequence of functions g1, this is g2, g3. Okay, g1 to be F2, G2 to be F4, G3 to be F6, and so on. Then for this is a subsequence. And what is the limit of this subsequence x power 2 power n in the interval close 0 comma 1? That we already know. This is 1. If you put the value 1, then this converges to 1 and 0 otherwise. There is no problem about point-wise limit. So this subsequence has a point-wise limit. Similarly, the odd subsequent also has the point-wise limit. So we have at least two So if f 2n plus 1 of x will be minus x power 2n plus 1. So this is an odd number. So you get minus x power 2n plus 1. Okay. So I define this to be Hn of x. This sequence, odd subsequence, converges to this function. If you put 1, I'll get minus 1 as a pointless limit. Everywhere else, it is anyway 0. So there are two subsequences for this sequence. You can find which converges pointwise. So there is a pointwise convergence subsequence is true. Fn has no pointwise convergence subsequence is false. Fn has exactly one pointwise convergence subsequence is also false because we have two. Okay. So this is the last problem, but I couldn't prepare this problem completely. So I leave this problem as an exercise. I just briefly say how to approach this problem. So find out which of the following series converges uniformly for x belongs to minus pi comma pi. Okay. So again, like summation an sequence of numbers is convergent. So convergent means that the series of partial term converges. Okay. So we really don't know what is the meaning of, I mean, the summation n equal to 1 to infinity an, it is just a symbol. It doesn't mean anything. So we give a meaning to the symbol by you look at the sequence of partial sums. A1 plus A2, A1 plus A2 plus A3, and so on. So given a sequence an, we say that we are defining summation n equal to 1 to infinity an to be convergent if you are defining some number sequence, because number sequence, we know how to find the convergence. Given epsilon greater than 0, there exists a stage. After that stage, so and so, we know how to calculate the convergence. So we say that this summation a n equal to 1 to infinity an is convergent if the corresponding partial sums, this number sequence, should be convergent. That is the definition of infinite series. Okay. So even though we are saying it is infinite series, we are not really doing infinite. We are looking at a limit of finite summations. Okay. Okay. So using the same idea, we want to define summation n equal to 1 to infinity fn of x, series of function also. So we know how to talk about sequence of functions. So now the series of function is defined to be fn of x plus f2 of x. So this is another function. So f1 is one function, f1 plus f2 is another function. So again, f1 plus f2 plus f3 is again function. So this is called as partial sums. And so this is a function, this is another function, this is another function. So you get a sequence of functions. So if this sequence of function converges to a function pointwise, then we see that this series converges to this limiting function pointwise. If this convergence is uniform, then we say that this series is converges to this limiting function. Series of function converges to this limiting function uniform. Again, using partial sums only. Okay. So to check whether a sequence converges uniform, series converges uniformly or not, we have Weierstrass M test, which is very, very useful. So it says that the conclusion is summation fn of x converges uniformly. So what are all the hypotheses? So fn is a sequence of real or complex valued function defined on a set A. If modulus of fn of x less than or equal to a number mn for each n, and suppose the summation mn is a number series, suppose this series is convergent, then summation n equal to infinity fn of x converges uniformly. I'll say one example. So the first option is fn of x equal to e power minus n mod x by n cube. So since you have minus, you can put this is equal to
Hello, sir.
So my voice is audible?
little breaking, sir.
My voice is audible?
Now it is audible, sir. Now it is audible, sir.
Okay, so this 1 by E. Okay, great. So for a fixed X, this sequence goes to 0. That means that for sufficiently large N, you can make this number less than or equal to 1. Okay, so some sequence goes to 0 means like it is going very closer to 0 for large N. So we get modulus of e power mod nx less than or equal to 1. We don't need to put this modulus, but it is fine. So therefore, we get 1 by e power n mod x times n cube is less than or equal to 1 by n cube, because this quantity is less than or equal to 1. So each function fn is bounded by 1 by n cube. That is what we get. And we know that summation 1 by n cube is convergent. Summation 1 by n power p is convergent if p is greater than 1. So by that result, summation 1 by n cube is convergent. So we can use Weierstrass m test. We get this series of function converges uniformly. We don't need the limit function. We just need whether the series converges uniformly or not. Okay. Yeah. So I share the notes. I couldn't complete this problem. I had no time when I was preparing the evening. Yeah. So I'll stop here. We can look at the notes to understand remaining stuff.
Hello, sir.
Hello.
Sir, can you say tell me the difference between pointwise convergence, uniform convergence, and uniform continuity? Means what is the main difference? I cannot see.
So as I said, like one. Okay, so maybe I'll write. Say I have a function. Maybe uniform continuity and all, it's very different concept. We don't need to go to uniform continuity. So suppose fn goes to f pointwise. Okay. So it means that fn of x converges to f of x, the sequence fn of x. So fix x, that is a thing. So fn, we say it is converges, is a sequence of function from e to r, e is some subset of r. First you fix a x. Once you fix a x, you get for varying x, you get a number sequence. And this number sequence converges to some number that we define it to be f of x. Okay. Now, given epsilon greater than 0, since fn of x converges to f of x, there exists stage n0 such that modulus of fn of x minus f of x less than epsilon. I should have write fm of x, because there is already a n. Fm of x minus f of x. There is a problem. No, there is no problem. I could have used greater than or equal to, for all m greater than or equal to n naught, right? So what happens is, in the pointwise convergence, for each point, the stage depends on the point also. Okay, so there exist n naught, but this n naught depends on both epsilon and x. Okay, so this n naught of epsilon comma x means that this n naught depends on both epsilon and x. Okay, so for example, like now I understand your question. In case of continuity, we saw that the epsilon, that the delta that exists for epsilon, that depends on the points. But in uniform continuity, for each epsilon, the delta whatever we are getting, that is independent of the point. Similarly, for each epsilon, we are finding a stage. That stage is independent of the point if the convergence is uniform. Okay, that is the main difference. Yeah, that's a good question.
Yeah. Okay, sir.
So maybe for 1 or 2 minutes.
Okay, the question where you use the alternating test series actually. Alternating series test.
About this Leibniz rule, right?
So in this question you prove that GN is this is the test for the number series, right? So number series, so when I fix x, then I will get GN x naught will be a number series, right? If I put x is equal to x naught.
Yeah. Correct, correct. What you are saying is exactly correct. So point-wise limit exists.
Yeah. So how could
the Leibniz test?
So how could you say that?
So I'm not saying. Right. Now I understand your confusion. Like by Leibniz test, by this Leibniz test, point-wise limit exists. That is true. But I'm not saying that. I'm not saying GN converges uniformly because of Leibniz test. I am not saying that. I am saying that. So. So you assume these things, and like say this is a theorem, okay, and these are the hypothesis, and I claim that GN tend to GN converges uniformly. That is the hypothesis I am claiming. So how to prove this statement? Okay, what I am saying is to prove this result, you check the proof of Leibniz test.
Yeah,
proof of this fact. You imitate the proof here, we get the proof of this result also. That is what I'm saying.
Yeah. Okay. So for uniform convergence, we have to use, lastly, you mentioned about the Amann test, right?
Amann test.
You have, we have to use the Amann test here for the uniform convergent. I think it's correct.
No, here I think what you're saying is correct. We have to use Amann test. I mean, it will be boils down to using this fact. This series is converges. Yeah. What you're saying is correct. But again, this GN GN is FN is decreasing is important. FN
For the point wise limit. Otherwise, how could we know that it is going to uniformly? Right.
But FN converges uniformly is also important. Converges to uniformly to zero also important. If it converges uniformly to some other function, then the conclusion is wrong. So each of these are very, very important conclusions. So is it not audible for everybody?
No, sir, it's audible. It's audible. It's audible, sir.
Sir, one last question. In some of questions, it is asked like find out the limit also in for the case limit of series. Series of functions. So how should we encounter that?
So basically we need to know some simplification technique. So maybe in that problems, like we have to use this as some infinite series we know, right? For example, sine, cos, tan. So by using the log also. So using the series expansion, we have to find the, we can't find, we have to just guess what would be the possible limit. If that is a if that is the point wise limit, then it should be the uniform limit also. I really haven't seen any such problem, so I don't have much clear idea about it. So you might have seen this book, right? The problems in real analysis. There are three parts.
At the starting edge that you showed, right?
KACZOR. Yeah, that is a very nice book. You can see many. It is for real analysis to solve problems. This book is very helpful. Like I have solved many problems from this book also, like in my YouTube channel. Yeah, so you can check that also. So basically, I try to make the channel self-contained one, whatever minimum requirement to clear the CSR exam, I want to cover all of things in the YouTube channel. So hopefully before the CSR exam, I can do that. Then it will be very good. Already, I have uploaded about some 110 videos. So again, about real analysis, you need some help in the beginning. So so better to watch some videos and learn some techniques and understand some concept, then it will be easy. Yeah, that is why I am suggesting the videos. Yeah.
Okay, sir. Thank you. Okay.
Maybe we can stop here. Yeah. So please, I'll share any doubts in the group. We can discuss in the group. Okay. Thank you.
Sir, thank you, sir. Harun, sir. Thank you for your nice lecture, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, madam. Thank you, madam.
Thank you, participants. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you all. Thank you. The next session we will meet.